We got people coming in now. That's great. Ben, what's your weather like out there?
It's been interesting. It's new, kind of humid and muggy, thunderstorms. There's this interesting microclimate here on the North Shore of Lake Superior. So it's been all over. It's pretty wacky, a lot to adjust to, but it's cool. A new experience for sure.
I love it. I love it.
Yeah.
Wonderful. This is great. Well, it's 11:30, so I feel compelled to be punctual and begin. Welcome all of you that have come today to watch Ben's excellent presentation on the white salmon and the ongoing spawning survey work that we're doing there. I'm gonna have Ben, just real quick, gonna have Ben do his presentation, and then I'm gonna talk just a quick minute about the upcoming training for our ongoing spawning surveys. And then we'll be fielding questions. If you'd like, go ahead and stick your questions now or during the presentation, just type them into the chat and we'll be having a record of those and we can address those at the end. For those of you who don't know, my name is J. Michelle Swope and I'm the Washington coordinator for Native Fish Society. And we're coming up on our third season of doing citizen science on the white salmon tributaries. And this is our good friend and excellent volunteer, Ben Levia, who actually is heralding from Duluth. Well, Ben, I'll let you talk about where you're heralding. He is not in state right now. but he's been gracious enough to join us for this presentation. So I am going to let Ben take it away and present, and then we'll all come back together and talk. And thank you so much for attending today.
Yeah, thanks, J. Michelle. Yeah, I'm out here seasonally in Duluth, but I'll be back soon enough to get back out on those trips, keep those surveys rolling. So I'll go ahead and share my screen here, start the presentation. Is that showing up all right for everyone? Hope so. Cool. Well, thank you all so much for joining. For those of you who may be watching this as a recording at a future date, thank you so much for taking the time. Again, my name is Ben, and for the past several seasons, I've been conducting surveys, spawning surveys, out on these tributaries of the White Salmon River. It's been a really phenomenal experience for me, so I'm really excited to share a bit about that with you all. For my presentation, I'll be starting with some background on the river, some history there. I'll walk you all through the spawning surveys themselves, just chatting a bit about what it's like, how it all goes down, just to give you that insight. And then share a bit more just about the experience, how cool it is. We're excited to tell the story, but ultimately the goal of this presentation is to encourage others to join us. There are certainly many other volunteers besides myself who have participated, so a huge shout out to those folks. We really appreciate it, but we'd love to have more of you join us. So wrapping up with some of that too, encouraging more to participate. So this map here is of course the outline of Washington State. You can see here that blue blotch in the lower left portion of the corner represents the watershed boundary of the White Salmon River watershed. It kind of straddles the climatic divide of sorts between the more wet, precipitous southwestern portion of the state and the more dry, arid south central portion of Washington State, and thus is affectionately referred to by many as the place where sun meets rain. The White Salmon River is located on the traditional homelands of the Klickitat people, one of the many native tribes of the region and native people of the Columbia River Basin. And while certainly acknowledging that we are on stolen land is important, particularly in the context of seeking to restore abundant runs of anadromous fish, I think it's important for us also to acknowledge and recognize that the native people of these rivers and of this landscape have coexisted alongside these native fish through time immemorial. And with that comes a depth and knowledge and understanding that I believe will play a critical role in efforts to restore these fish. And for those of us engaged in stewardship of our rivers, certainly an important piece of that is also seeking to be advocates and seek allyship in authentic, respectful ways with the people of these rivers. This map here represents the path of flow of the main stem of the White Salmon River. As you can see, it is a glacially fed river. It originates on the southwestern slopes of Mount Adams, where it then flows for approximately 45 miles before terminating into the Columbia River, approximately 180 miles upstream from the Pacific Ocean. So it is upstream of Bonneville Dam and is in what's considered the mid-Columbia River. Symbology-wise, the pink or magenta segment there of the river represents the native range of Anadromi within the watershed. That little green waterfall symbol is Big Brother Falls, a kind of over 20-foot sheer drop of a waterfall that acts as a natural barrier to Anadromi within the watershed. Let's see, here are a few images of some of the habitat located in the river. It's a very high gradient stream, many chutes and drops and waterfalls, a very, very popular whitewater destination, and portions of it designated as wild and scenic, and it is most certainly a scenic and beautiful river. The watershed is home to a number of various native fish species, certainly the river's namesake, the Tule Fall Chinook salmon, as well as other runs of Chinook, coho, steelhead, certainly resident micus or rainbow trout, coastal cutthroats, bull trout, Pacific lamprey, certainly a number of other smaller native fish species, no less important to the watershed. And in addition, as a glacially fed river in the mid-Columbia, it provides that ever important cold water refugia for so many other fish as they migrate through the Columbia River. So in terms of background, one of the most dramatic and significant aspects of this river's history was the construction and subsequent removal of the Conduit Dam. The dam was originally constructed in 1911 and completed in 1912. At the time of its construction, providing fish passage was certainly not a thought of that time. Over the duration of the dam's lifespan, I believe there were efforts made to provide that passage. Those were unsuccessful. So for nearly a full century, while the dam was in place, it acted as an artificial barrier to Anadromi. And this map here gives you a bit of a sense of how dramatic that impact was. The little bullseye symbol representing the location of Conduit Dam, just a little over 2 miles upstream from the mouth of the river. So all of the main stem habitat entirely inaccessible while the dam was in place, and all of these smaller yellow lines representing important spawning tributaries that were also completely inaccessible to the anadromous fish of this river. In 1999, when relicensing for the dam came up, it was determined that the dam would be removed, although it was a bit of a process. So eventually in 2011, the initial breach of Conduit Dam occurred. You can see this image capturing those first few moments of the dam removal. And within a year's time, by 2012, Conduit Dam was completely removed. And you can see here the river returning to its natural channel. So at the time of its removal, Conduit was actually the largest scale dam removal in US history at that time. And this large scale ecological restoration effort is referred to by many as a rewilding of the river, which certainly refers to the river itself, restoring those natural ecosystem watershed processes that occur, which of course includes the migration of anadromous fish throughout the watershed. But in the case of the white salmon, rewilding also refers to the composition of the fish within the river. There is currently not a hatchery program on the white salmon. So that provides a very fascinating and very important opportunity for us to seek to understand the efficacy of natural wild repopulation of a watershed following a large-scale dam removal. So that certainly is important for us to understand for the white salmon itself, but also has implications and bearing for dam removal projects elsewhere in the Columbia River Basin and beyond. In addition, part of Washington State's steelhead management plan includes designating certain streams as wild steelhead gene bank rivers to kind of preserve some of the genetic structure of these wild runs. And while the white salmon does not currently have that gene bank designation, part of collecting this data for this project is perhaps contributing to seeing if that may become the case. So leading up to and following the dam's removal, there's been a significant amount of excellent work done by a number of agencies, some really fascinating research and really cool literature to review out there. A lot of excellent monitoring, but certainly the North American model of wildlife conservation has its shortcomings, and there are simply too few funding dollars available to consistently monitor all of this anadromous habitat. But that does provide an opportunity for non-governmental organizations to step up and contribute to these monitoring efforts. So for this project, Native Fish Society has coordinated closely with Washington Department of Fish and Wildlife. A huge shout out to Jay Michelle for making this project happen. And we've been able to organize volunteers acting as citizen scientists out on these tributaries of the white salmon conducting spawning surveys. So for this project, we have three creeks in the watershed that we focus on, Mill, Buck, and Spring Creek. There are five stream reaches total, one each on Mill and Spring. And now on Buck Creek, we have three separate stream reaches designated. Our survey season runs from October through May. We focus on coho and steelhead spawning activity in these tribs. We operate on either a 10 or 14 day rotation for these surveys. That's the protocol for the methodology used in these surveys. There is a bit of flexibility there in terms of volunteers who are interested. It doesn't mean we're specifically every 10th or every 14th day, but somewhere within that time span. But certainly the more folks we have joining, the better equipped we are to keep our surveys in rotation and adhere to that protocol. The data is collected electronically via an iPad. So for anyone who uses a smartphone or a tablet, it's very easy and comfortable to navigate, easy to use. We collect data points on observations of live adults when we encounter them, of course, doing our best to get an ID on whether there's an adipose fin or not to determine any hatchery stray presence on these spawning grounds. There is the option to collect biological data, scale samples, and other biodata should we encounter carcasses. But the primary data point that we're collecting on these surveys are tracking the reds, which are, of course, the nests that salmonids will dig in the stream substrate in order to deposit their eggs and milt and seed the next generation of fish. So for these surveys, we're out hiking, walking alongside these streams, or in some cases directly through the channel. We're carefully searching and looking to spot the reds. Upon identifying a red, we will hang flagging on nearby vegetation, as well as these little scannable barcodes. So each red has a unique ID number that on subsequent surveys, we scan and track that red based on its condition as visually observed. So on follow-up surveys, will enter into the iPad as well as right on the flagging itself, the red status, whether it is still visible, unable to be observed based on the conditions, and certainly the survey data at which it becomes no longer visible. So the data we collect creates a red census, the total number of reds that occur on these spawning grounds and the longevity of those reds. For this past spawning season, I personally focused on Mill Creek and Spring Creek. Again, there's been other volunteers contributing to this project. We're so grateful for everyone who participates. So this data that I'm sharing is specific just to the surveys that I conducted. On this map here, the light blue or kind of that cyan blue color of the tribs represents those stream reaches. Here are a few images of these creeks. They're both rather small second and third order tributaries. I can pretty much step right across them in most places, but they certainly have excellent and important spawning and rearing habitat. For Mill Creek, here's a very simple basic graph of the temporal distribution, the timing of spawning as observed by the presence of reds in Mill Creek, a total of 4 coho reds and 7 steelhead reds, a fairly narrow window of spawning activity for each. These are small tribs. And of course, this rewilding, we're still learning what can happen in there. This map is the spatial distribution of spawning activity within the Mill Creek stream reach. One thing I like about the aerial photo of this base map, you can see that tree line is what had formerly been the high water mark of Northwestern Lake, which was the reservoir created by Condit Dam. So it's really, really cool to see wild fish spawning right up alongside or basically right within a habitat that up until just a decade ago was entirely inhospitable for spawning, and really speaks to what we can do when we get some dams out of the way and let these fish come on back. Spring Creek, similar graph, similar story as well, a bit more spawning activity. It is a longer stream reach there, about 2/3 of a mile. We had 11 coho reds and 10 steelhead reds. Again, pretty narrow window of spawning activity with these kind of strong spikes right off the bat and then pretty quickly tapering off. The spatial distribution of spawning activity in Spring Creek, fairly wide distribution there with certainly some overlapping in the prime spawning gravel. And then the two species occupying some distinctly different portions of the reach, with steelhead digging a few reds right at the very mouth of the creek. And then coho going all the way up top to an area where there's been some blowdown of the riparian, a bit more exposed in that area, but the coho just kind of do it right out in the open. They don't seem to care. So what does all this mean? This data that I've collected and spent all these many hours out there tromping around and other folks who contribute to this project. This data that we gather contributes to a larger data set that the state monitoring that is used to create population abundance estimates for these species within the watershed. So the work that we're doing as a part of this project really provides some additional shading in and helps paint that picture of the rewilding of the river. You know, this is kind of large-scale dam removal is this new frontier of understanding how we can go about bringing back wild abundance and how we can help heal the earth. And so it's really cool to get to go out and contribute to that body of work. If we draw the lens out a little further, this is of course just one watershed within the state of Washington. So this of course also contributes to a statewide understanding of how anadromy is faring out on the state level. And even further on a landscape-wide scale, you know, this river is a tributary of this massive Columbia River Basin. And while it's certainly easy for this data to feel pretty minuscule or like just a drop in the bucket on this huge scale, I would argue that every little bit of data that we can contribute to knowing and understanding what's going on with anadromy out on this landscape, the better equipped we are to try and restore it. So some big picture stuff and really cool opportunity to contribute to that. One of the other really cool things about this project is that you're invited. Everyone is welcome. You too can come experience this place where the sun meets the rain and come be a part of helping tell this story of the rewilding of the white salmon. This really is for everyone. Certainly anglers, you know, for those of you out there who want to try and answer that call to contribute to conservation and be involved, this is for you. Certainly phone calls and letter writing and public comments are so important, but this project is a really fun and engaging, actionable step you can take to get out and contribute to these efforts. We'd also love to encourage folks who enjoy the resource by whitewater rafting to come check it out. You know, it's a beautiful river. So those folks who love it and love those rapids, we encourage you to come see another side of the watershed and see some of these, the smaller water that the river has to offer. And in addition, anyone who appreciates the natural world, it's just a beautiful place. And certainly being able to help document and observe and monitor the rewilding of this river is a really cool opportunity to be a part of. For this project, all training and equipment is provided. Certainly that training is a critical component. J. Michelle will be speaking more about that, but it's certainly crucial that we're collecting accurate data. Again, all the gear and necessary equipment is provided. We're so very grateful and thankful to the wonderful folks at Patagonia for donating many pairs of waders and wading boots to us. And we have easy access to those at a location right near where we survey. So we got you covered. If you don't have your own gear, or even if you do, you don't need to wear, you don't need to tear up your own waders. We got you covered. So we're trying to minimize any barriers to entry. And beyond that, you know, I've been talking a bit about why this project is so important and why this data that we're collecting really matters. But it's also just a lot of fun. It's a really cool way to experience this beautiful place that we live in and enjoy. And so I'll kind of wrap the presentation up with a bit of eye candy and kind of sharing with you what this project means to me. So these tributaries are rather small, beautiful little tucked away, in my opinion, these hidden gems of this watershed, right? So many of us who enjoy rivers, you know, we're out in the big water, maybe running the rapids or wading out into the run. But these little tribs are these kind of tucked away, little hidden, beautiful places in a really intimate way to get to experience a watershed. And in many instances, at least for me, you know, I'm the only one there. You know, there's solitude or some of these places no one else ever really goes. So there's something pretty special and magical to be said about that aspect of the experience. Certainly these are beautiful places, right? All these wonderful wildflowers I've had the opportunity to witness out there. These lupins blooming here, just something really special in that this location is right along the hillside at the mouth of Spring Creek. So this hillside had previously been submerged underwater, was buried by Northwestern Lake, this artificial reservoir. And here we are a decade later seeing these native flowers just blooming brilliantly in this hillside. So again, another testament to what we can do when we give our rivers a chance to restore themselves. beautiful checkered lily, a calypso, fairy slipper orchid there. And so much cool biota. Here's some really cool fungi I've seen out there. The lion's mane mushroom and ice hair fungus are really unique, fascinating species that you might encounter on these surveys. And then all manner of wildlife beyond just the fish, cool mammals. This is an awesome elk skull. There's a herd of elk that enjoy the area of Spring Creek. I encounter them and see elk sign very regularly. Tons of cool bird watching opportunities there. This is just an empty cup nest, but certainly many observations made. I often spook out grouse, more so the grouse spook me. Wild turkey, come spring migration time, all the warblers are moving through. It's just really cool to see. Plenty of herping to be had out there, certainly frogs and salamanders. This image is of a Western garter snake in Mill Creek. Cool observation for me, the snake was actually fishing for juvenile coho. I was unaware that the Western garters would become piscivorous, but here was this fish in this cold, or this snake rather, in this cold water hunting for juvenile coho, which also speaks to the importance of bringing these fish back, right? They benefit all of the wildlife in these connected ecosystems. So in addition, you know, for me, these surveys really is time on the water. And just like a good day out fishing, you know, it's beautiful to be out there. It's a special thing that we can be grateful to experience. And you don't always encounter fish, but when you do, it can be pretty exciting. So I'll wrap it up with a few videos, some special moments I captured during these surveys. These are all from Spring Creek. Here's a pair of what I ID'd as resident micus. And here they are spawning. You can see their dorsals out of the water there, sort of caught in the act. So a really special, intimate moment to be able to witness and just see, for me, very exciting, really cool, and just beautiful shot of these wild fish doing their thing. Here's Spring Creek, a small pot of coho. You can see that the male with his bright red spawning colors, and then that larger female with her tail all beat up from digging reds. Love to see it, just a really cool observation to be had. And then a few short weeks later, these juvenile coho, the little ones who have emerged from the gravel, and here they are just living it up in this beautiful habitat, this woody debris, that's, you know, this important habitat that they now can access in these tributaries that they were blocked from for so long. But here they are doing their thing. You know, certainly very few of these fish will survive to return to spawn, but still very special to get to see them grow up and survey after survey, see them get a little bigger each time and see them doing their thing. One final video here again, juvenile coho in Spring Creek. Here they are feeding in the drift, getting bigger and preparing to get larger and larger before they move back out to the ocean. Hopefully we'll see more of them return next year. So that about does it. I so appreciate everyone taking the time to hear my story. I'm really grateful to J. Michelle for providing this opportunity for me to be a part of this project. And for anyone who's interested or knows someone who might, I really encourage you to reach out to J. Michelle. She can get you dialed in. She'll be talking more about training opportunities. And if anyone has feedback or input or questions for me, my email's there, please feel free to reach out. So with that, I'll stop the share and kick it back over to J. Michelle.
Ben, what an excellent presentation. Oh my gosh.
Thank you.
Absolutely beautiful and lovely. I do want to, first of all, I forgot to add, this is all being recorded, which means now everyone on here is famous. No, we're going to edit a little and post this on our YouTube channel so if other folks can see Ben's presentation. But I did want to let you all know who are attending that also you will be on the video. I did want to acknowledge that we have the original, the OG river steward of the white salmon, Paul Fortino, is joining us today. So hi, Paul. And I just want to give a shout out because without Paul, frankly, this would not be the project it is today. He identified a need. He is passionate about the river. He even lets us use his property to shed to store our equipment. Like, he's just incredible. So applause and many thanks to Paul for really getting us off the ground. So we are entering our third season of spawning surveys on the white salmon, and we're very excited about it. And while I talk a little bit about the upcoming training and project, please, if you want, put in some any questions you have in the chat, and we'll be addressing those. But so we have a training coming up August 27th or August 28th. Both days are happening. It's the same training. One could select either to come that Saturday or that Sunday. You don't need to attend both. That training, though, incorporates a couple really important things. One is that we get to actually boots on the ground, go see these beautiful places that Ben just showed us via video. And we sort of learn. We also have iPads on loan from Washington Department of Fish and Wildlife. And we just kind of run through how to use those and how to do a spawning survey. And I just want to, if anyone's nervous at all, you don't have to be a scientist. You don't have to be even like me, crazed angler to do spawning surveys. You just have to like to walk in the woods and look in water. That's really the only requirements. Everything else we have covered. I have training to send you. You can look through. I'll send, if you're new to spawning surveys, we'll send you out with someone who's more seasoned. We do everything we can in order to keep these 10-day and 14-day windows going as we move from fall through till the end of spring. So just to let you know, that is one of the things that we try really hard to do is to pair people up. So if you are interested at all or have any questions or know folks who want to do this spawning survey work with us, please shout out, text me, write me, carrier pigeon me. I would love to speak more about this with you. I do want to give a little bit of a shout out to both Friends of the White Salmon, which Paul Fortino got us involved with, that has helped us kick off this project, as well as our partners at Region 5 WDFW. A special shout out goes to Lisa Brown, who's the ESA expert for Coho, and Stephen Gray, who's the ESA expert for Steelhead, who are both working in that region of the White Salmon. They've been really instrumental in both lending us equipment, lending us all their perfectly beautiful training materials, and really walking with us along the reaches to ensure that volunteers who go out can do it effectively, well, and are safe. And on the safety side of things, I do want to add that Butt Creek is a very, very long, it's second longest to Rattlesnake. Buck is quite long. We were successful this summer in actually shortening the reaches. So if any of you have heard from anyone else about how long Buck Creek is, they're not wrong. But the good news is that our work on Buck Creek has been shortened, so it's much more manageable this season. So just an FYI. So do we have any questions, comments? I don't see any questions coming through.
I may have a question. Joe,
it looks like William has a question.
Awesome.
William, do you want to ask that question or do you want me to read it for you? I'll just go ahead and read it. Do you have any historical data on the populations or red counts for the white salmon and its tributaries?
I can chime in a little bit with what I know there too. Sorry to cut you off, JM. So all that data, the Washington Department of Fish and Wildlife does have sort of a database that you can access through their website. So there's data available there. Also, I do know that prior to us picking up these surveys, and perhaps Paul can join in and JM as well, I know Yakima Nation Fisheries were conducting some regular surveys of these trips. So that data is out there. I personally don't have those data points. I can't speak to those specific numbers, but there is some historical data that precedes this project.
And any historical data that proceeds will be folded into the stats Ben just offered. Also, the Yakima tribe, I should have mentioned that there are four tributaries to the white salmon. We do spawning surveys on three. The Yakima tribe currently does Rattlesnake Creek, which is the most prolific creek for steelhead and is also the longest reach. And their data is also contained within the WDFW database. So it's all there, extracting it. Could be interesting, but it is all there. What we have is in that database.
I had some information that I believe I've given to Jay Michelle, but it was a historical document which showed that at some points, the White Salmon River was the third most prolific steelhead river in the entire state of Washington. Now, it's hard for me to believe that there were that many when there was that dam in place for 100 years, but they had a huge number below the dam. And as I said, it in that 2 miles or 2.5 miles, they had just a ton of fish.
Yes, thank you, Paul. Absolutely. And if we want to get more into that, you're welcome to contact myself or Ben or Paul, and we can talk more about that and get into the nitty gritty. Although I took Paul's book from him, so you can contact me. The other thing I wanted to mention, just really quick, because I'm conscious about, you know, if any of us has filled our gas tanks lately, wow, that's a steep cost that we're incurring. So I did want to mention that we do have fuel assistance available for folks who are potentially interested in coming to the white salmon to do spawning surveys, but are just concerned about the resources that are involved to get there and back. So I did want to make sure that to emphasize that there is fuel assistance available, and I would love to talk with you more about that should that be something you're interested in. Any other comments or questions?
Just a quick one from me. This is Phil Trask. So I was wondering, you know, you have some data, number of spawning sites, when they're being used. Do you have a sense of what a normal density would be for a system that hasn't had a dam in place? And a sort of a second question, are there pit tag arrays in the mouth of the white salmon to get an understanding? It seemed to me there was quite a bit of monitoring that was proposed at the time of the takeout of the dam. And I don't know, I know the early history there, but I don't know post-removal history. Those two things would be interesting for a little bit of context.
Phil, thanks for asking that question. I can't address it directly too much. I do know in doing a little bit of literature review that USGS continues to do a lot of cool monitoring. They've run screw traps out there to capture some data on out-migrating adults and smolts. So there's some data points there. I can't speak to those numbers specifically. And then, yeah, that's about all I got to answer your question. I'm sure perhaps Jay Michelle and Paul or others can shade in some more detail there.
Yeah, just my quick observation is that with data all over the Columbia Basin and really around the world, you gather data, but it's so hard to get money and funding to do synthesis. You know, what does it all mean? And so I really applaud the effort to get out and get that that data, especially at these small tributary levels. You know, it really helps to paint a picture. But, you know, one of the roles for Native Fish Society might be to think about doing what the state agencies often don't, or the federal agencies, is to synthesize it and say, what do we think this means? And that's always a really interesting thing to do. And, you know, always expensive and always hard to get money for, but very important.
Absolutely. And for me, part of this project has been really gaining skills and knowledge and just immersing myself in that. I'm going through school and seeking, you know, to forge a career path that I can hopefully someday be qualified to answer those questions. So being, for me, I'm kind of in it long-term. I love being out there, and hopefully someday, Phil, I can have the knowledge and the means to help answer some of your questions more directly. So we'll
great see. Job, Ben. Great job.
One of the points that everybody should be aware of is that while billions, and I mean billions, have been spent on salmon restoration in the Columbia Basin, they don't see fit to give any money to the tributaries. And it makes absolutely no sense, because the tributaries are the best chance for these places to help the Columbia system. And this is a place which has no dams between it and the Pacific Ocean now. And I'm frustrated to some extent by the failure to do this on a governmental basis, but I'm so happy that people have taken this interest. And Ben, that was just a spectacular presentation. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Paul. Thanks again for giving us access and having the shed. It's a delight, or yeah, just so grateful for your help and support in making this all happen. Oh, and quick mention, there is the one dam, right, Paul? There's still Bonneville, so they have to get through that, right, to get to the White Salmon. But just the one, not four or eight or, yeah.
And that one has pretty good fist passage. I'm not writing home about it, but it's a lot better than some of them.
Hi, everyone. Can I chime in? My name is Margaret Newman. I'm the director of Mid-Columbia Fisheries Enhancement Group, and I live in White Salmon. And I just want to go back to Phil's question. And also thank you guys for doing this work. And Paul's right. It's really frustrating that there's not more money for monitoring. Like, my group has found some grant money to support monitoring, but it's really hard, few and far between. Like, the agencies want to invest in restoration, and that's great. But like in this particular river, like $32 million was spent on removing Condit Dam, and very little has been spent on monitoring the results of that project. And that's, so it's great that you guys have been able to step in and help. But yeah, USGS has been running that fish smolt trap down low in the basin. And I put a link in the chat to like their presentation from 2019. I haven't seen a more recent one. They didn't run the smolt trap in 2020, but I think they ran it in 2021. I don't know about 2022, but it is a really good way for folks to learn about who's out migrating out of the river. So it's just like another piece of the puzzle with like the kind of data you guys are getting and other surveys that are out there.
Thank you, Margaret. That's good.
Thanks, Margaret.
Another just real point that I wanted to sort of emphasize, Ben actually did a great job of touching on this in your presentation, and thanks again. But you know, the data that we're getting from this White Salmon work also helps us paint a larger picture around gene banks in Washington State. There were 14 identified, 7 were selected. The White Salmon is the same characteristic of a gene bank, it just wasn't selected to be one. But we're looking at similar streams with similar characteristics, and potentially the story science could lead us in the direction of this might be a way that we can sort of prove over time that truly rewilding is an effective way to repopulate our anadromous fish populations. It would be another way to show folks who really want to see the data that rewilding actually does work and can be effective. So, I mean, that's why it's so important to me that we continue this work. This isn't a 2 or 3 year project. This is an ongoing project. And if and when we can get more sources and more funding, we'll do this work on other streams that need the help, and that data collection is necessary. So just wanted to comment. Any other questions or comments or anything?
One comment, and that is that we hear an awful lot about heat these days. And as a person who lives on the White Salmon River, I can tell you that is one cold river almost 365 days a year. And I suspect that cold water refuge idea really is a big part of the value of that river. It just plunges straight from the mountain down to the Columbia, and the plume of colder water in the warm Columbia just has to be a valuable asset. I'm unable to quantify any of that.
Yeah, certainly cold water refugia is a definite thing we need to take. We need to notice, and we need to talk about. We need to talk about more. It's one of the things that Oregon has done fairly well on their side of the Columbia, is talk about cold water refugia. And it's one thing that, it is a thing that I would like WDFW and push them to talk about more and pay more attention to. Certainly as we move through things around climate change, it's an ongoing concern. Rob, you don't need to raise your hand, but I really appreciate the fact that you did.
Hey, everybody. I'm in my third year, I guess, of residence in the Rattlesnake Creek Basin. So can't quite throw a rock to your place, Paul, but close. I had a couple questions. One, I was looking for the Yakima data on the Rattlesnake Creek spawning surveys. I've been exploring some of that stuff, some of the creek on the upper reaches or below Rattlesnake Creek Falls, which are substantial and beautiful. The other comment I had, my neighbor on three sides and one of the largest landholders on Rattlesnake Creek and a significant landholder on White Sam River itself recently sold their timber business. And so what the impact, having lived on the coast for a long time and had to withstand the impacts of corporate timber as our neighbors, from everything from air quality to water quality, drinking water supply quality to every aspect of the environment. I felt like maybe the gorge region is not quite as sophisticated as it needed to be when that deal went down. Not that there was anything that could be done, but I'm wondering if anybody has anticipated the impacts of that timber sale on issues across the board, you know, but specifically to the watersheds.
I'll give my input on that, Rob. I'm so glad you asked that question. That's a big concern of mine, particularly in that Spring Creek. That reach is right in what was SDS and now the new landowner. I'm not sure exactly. There's some LLC. I'm not sure. I looked them up. If they're from, you might know who they are. But yeah, that track, that thing's ready to go. It's been flagged up and spray painted. They got it. They got that thing ready to go. And so that's a big concern of mine for sure. And seeing all this beautiful habitat and these really some of my most prized special moments in there, seeing these fish do their thing. So I wish I had a more specific answer, but I would love to connect with you when I'm out there and see if we can, or Margaret or other folks in the community, and see what we can all get together and do. I know there were previous efforts through Friends of the White Salmon, that effort to like save Spring Creek, that creek from being cut. And so hopefully we can kind of restore some of that energy around it as this new landowner moves it, or as they start, you know, getting ready to do their thing in there. And hopefully we can, yeah, protect it.
Very nice. Rob, were you asking about data from the Yakima tribe around Rattlesnake?
Yeah, I think there was a brief mention earlier that maybe that was all aggregated at a Fish and Wildlife website or something.
It is, but if you want like just their data, I might contact Joe Zent, who's their fish bio, who's been really helpful as we sort of broke into this work on the white salmon. He was real helpful about different historical reaches and things. And Joe's he actually lives near white salmon, he'd probably be your quickest way into that data if you wanted that specifically.
Okay, great, thank you. Yeah, I'll contact him via email or something here in the next little bit.
All right. Well, we're approaching time. I just wanted to see if anyone else had any comments or questions. I have really enjoyed this conversation. It's so exciting to be with like-minded folks who want to talk about the white salmon and the surrounding area. It's really wonderful and tremendous. I would sort of invite you, if you're interested, as conversations hopefully continue around the timber sale and what is occurring in that landmass, if you are interested in being part of that conversation, would you please just throw me an email or something, or text me, and I will add you to a list, because I'm certain we're going to have some things to say about what's going to happen with that as the sale. I think the sale is completed, so as their plans move forward, for sure. And I also know that Friends of the White Salmon and Friends of Mount Adams, is that correct? Are merging? There's a merger happening with our nonprofits. Margaret, do I have that right? Great. So I've been waiting also to hear how that occurs, because I'd love to also get together with that new configuration of folk and maybe talk more about what we can do together.
Anybody who is going to participate in the later events or indeed doing spawning surveys, make sure you stop by the house and say hello. I'm not there all the time, but